yesterday that we could use towards the bill now, you know, so, you know, we have no idea whether that's gonna be a not enough, maybe that's not gonna be close to enough. We don't have a source for it.
So what we have is the architect, and Marty is Mark, and we're to the architect, and we're just starting. So we're gonna have a number of parallel things happening at the same time. So we saw the cost yesterday, out in the technology. So now we have to use the structure, so what it would take to get that done. And if things like the stars might have come, we'll start to have those numbers this week.
Yeah, we just have no idea.
So, because there are some aspects that has pushed it over, calling in the motion, but the building has problems. We just need to check out the structural piece, our architect is already done the work on the area. So we're moving very aggressively, because my plan is by June to come back, so tomorrow is the meeting with the teachers. For June, they will come back with revised plan, and then we'll have this to be across the structure. So that people have their own ultimate decision. I still want to say, we're not gonna be moving in July, we need to make this decision now, so that we can actually.
Is that just to renovate existing, not to bump out and add on?
I think it's just, right, everywhere else, this is, so I'm looking at this, understanding what the board is to get this space done, to be able to renovate that area. In talking with all the stakeholders, in on this time track, we can probably get that ready, but probably not day one. But it will be, we'll have some substantial condition like the walls. Then I think we can live in that area, I think it's prudent to live there, to try it out, to see what works. But do we need more, do we need less of, and then start talking about that building. Other thing that you need to remember, and I know Mark will talk about this later, is we have a potential high school renovation project, which could be moved, and it could be at that time, better to move things up on their own, and to take care of moving out that next bank of classrooms when we do a renovation upstairs, because that would be a major renovation. So I think right now, administration is comfortable in terms of where we're going, what we've seen, what the things that we've seen, in order to do this, unknowing us, is that sort of how it's together in the world. And then we have to start looking to the future, and what the high school renovation will look like, to be possible to do that.
So just my own takeaway from the meeting the other day about that space was, it really was taking those existing rooms and bringing them up to speed, but not addressing whether those particular rooms right there even fit the classes that would go in them. Because that's pretty much was literally take each room and outfit it to be more of a tech wing versus, I got a little concerned, I guess, when we're talking about robotics in the hallway, and I don't know that robotics in the hallway were because they wanted to be in, but more there needs to be a space for robotics that they don't currently have. So I'm a little concerned about an aggressive timeline in terms of, are we just prettying up rooms to a tech standard?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Absolutely not. What they are bringing forward is something that this building has never had. So the capability, the technology, the equipment that's gonna be in there is like nothing, quite honestly, in person. So we will be that trendsetter. When this redesign, it is not just a recompensing of those rooms, it's actually listening to what they, what was going on, what Mr. Simmons presented to curriculum earlier, is taking into account what they share and listening to them. Because the problem with windows is that sometimes you're only limited by what you see, right? And even if you go out and see other things, you say, oh, that's neat, oh, that's neat. We really need to go to experts in the field, do this for them. And we were impressed. They flew in a team from Texas, and they met with us to present this to us. They're folks who have degrees in education technology and design. So what they're presenting to us is the latest in this trend. Not so it becomes fashionable and is not sustainable, but what will work for what we have presented and presented like by our own folks. So, you know, I understand, like you're saying, with robotics and all, but however, we still need to have the meeting state with our teachers and members tomorrow, and then go from there. This is not a once and done, this will have multiple phases too.
I understand.
I'm, I, and I would not
70 grand include?
Would include technology such as iPads. There's still, I think, some focus on what exactly that's going to be. That's an estimated cost. Okay, that's not the final ask. I took blended of what we did here, what we did at West Reda, and made my own
assessment.
My own assessment. Yeah, and I worked with Mr. Arns on that too. It just wasn't my thought process.
No.
It was
yeah.
A collaboration. Okay, so it's just an estimate, right? Placeholder. Okay. Well, it could be a little high, but it would be a 3-year lease, which we so that we have a refresh. So that's what we cited as another tool. Okay, we're kind of used to this. We're in the third year of doing enrollment projections. The main focus here is 17-18. We're looking about an enrollment of 1,931 students. This is a little lower than projection we had for 17-18 last year because our October 1 enrollment was about 30 students less than we projected in 16-17, which decreased this. That's the reason why we're talking about class size. So our staffing model right now is perfect for the 1,931 students that we're looking at, especially in the elementary center. That's why we talked about that LTS position versus autistic support. Something new that we are trending on this right now is the special ed line. So these are the special ed numbers that don't include gifted. It's the special ed costs are to students. And the big thing here is as we have peaks and troughs in our enrollment, we get to this peak, we kind of dip down a little bit, we get to a peak, we have this trend. Okay? You can see special ed does not. This is a 26% increase from 07-08 to 17-18 in special ed students. So when we talk about making sure our ratios are proper with the number of support we have for our special ed department, that's where this is coming from, this number right here. We'll continue to monitor this. So this is a projection based upon the historical percentages from the ratio from here to here. So 320 is what we're projecting for 17-18. So that's an increase of 8 special ed students. It's just about right on point with what Mrs. Langle is projecting also.
Is that something that all districts are seeing? Do you talk to your cohorts in other districts? Is that a common thing to use across the
board? From some of my...
For special ed?
Yeah.
Because remember, we're getting more autistic students in the district than in other schools.
Well, I was just wondering across the board. The incidence.
No, more of a better expert. Yes, I just know the numbers. So, but I can definitely ask that question, put it out there. We have a big network that we have a lot of people share. So, that's currently where we are at the moment. So, right now.
Can I add something to that?
Sure.
But remember, we're also one of the districts that continues to increase enrollment. So, when you increase enrollment, there's naturally adjustment in the percentage that will be the special ed, but we're also bringing selecting our district to move into for our special ed services.
And one quick thing right here, because this number is going to not agree, it's because the state is not adopting new trend data as far as their projections and update their information. So this is the latest information about the state as far as what they are projecting. And we don't get their numbers at all. So just as a curiosity question. This is a brand new slide. I really want to enhance the presentation a little bit more and kind of show where we are as far as how we get our revenue. The main source of revenue, as we all know, is property taxes. This is our line graph that shows our real estate assessment from 11-12 to where we're projecting at 17-18. As you can see, we were about $817 million in assessed value. And then VF in the Highlands went for a reassessment, which dropped us 2.59% of the assessed value, which is $21 million for assessed value. Something that you can see we haven't recovered or probably will ever recover from. So it's a huge drop in your potential tax revenue. Okay, this correlates to how our village is right now. One of the factors is because of this drop right here. Okay. if I added the enrollment, which you just saw, to the assessed value, you can see big drop in assessed value, big increase in enrollment. Okay? As Scott was talking about, our tuition rate. Okay? This is the most recent data that the state put out. Obviously, it's quite higher now. But our tuition rate, which we don't charge for tuition, we don't accept students to be paid tuition. The state provides this for every school district. It's calculated off of our financial statements. That our tuition rate has increased. So we're spending more per student, but our real estate revenue drops significantly in 13-14. Just some trend information data that you can have to say, wow, you know, where would we be if there was no reassessment? We would be probably about, you know, maybe approaching a kind of $20 million. Great slide here. Village rates the first time. So I have a few 17-18 projections from some of the school districts that we're looking at, and then the highlighted ones. So right now, we're at 30.0665 bills, 16-17. That puts us at fifth in the county. It's the fifth highest village rate. Okay? NTM, obviously, Brandywine, Exeter, and okay, now.
Fleetwood?
Yes, Fleetwood. So those are the ones that are ahead of us. We did a tax increase last year, 0.95%. Some of our peers, Pohocken, zero. Schuylkill Valley did a tax increase for the first time in a couple years at 1.05%. We read in the paper on Monday, both Schuylkill Valley and Pohocken are projecting a 0% tax increase this year. I just want to lead your eyes over here to the far column, their 15-16 enrollment. We were at 1,900 students. Schuylkill Valley was at 2,000, and Pohocken was a little less at 1,400. Then I'm going to shift these right here. Your basic education funding. Okay? We're the lowest in the county at $1.5 million. Schuylkill Valley is a good 1.136 million ahead of us, and we have the same size population. And their tax millage rate is significantly lower than ours. So if you add in our assessment value drop in 13-14, the fact that we're slowly climbing up with increases with the new basic education formula. We're just not there as far as what we're getting from the state with our peer, which is Schuylkill Valley right here. Now, district dynamics are a little different. They're a little bit, you know, more rural than we are, but they do have significant build-out in the past couple of years. So, you know, just for information, Dolaten obviously is way ahead of us in the basic education plan. So, and also I have down here what our the borough rates are and the county's tax rate. So these will be all add-ons to this 34 for taxpayer. Millage history. This is a great chart. This shows our millage from 98-99 to where we could potentially be today. You see the Act 1 index here. This is when it was first brought out, but it was really enacted about this time right here. 09-10 is when it was put forth. Wow. So if I just want to draw your eyes to 99, 2000. This was the last time the district did a 0% tax increase, which seemed to work. But then, in the outer years here, we had some significant tax increases, 8%. Now, 13, 14 down here is when that the assessed value, that significant drop. Okay, they did a tax increase right at the back of the index. Okay? You'll never get this anymore, ever. In that one era, you'll never see these numbers. We don't know how that ability anymore to tax that high. One time shot. Okay, we're down around this area. Now our index has increased over the years, but not to the point where we'd be able to do a significant recovery if anything ever happened. For the past 3 years, we've had tax increases significantly less than the Act 1 index. So we've been trending down 1.5, 1.95 last year. Right now, because we didn't make that decision yet, I have a 0% in. Okay? The this is our increased summary. So this is what we could potentially receive in revenue if we were to do any version of tax exempt to the index, which is at 2.5. $568,000 additional tax revenue we could receive if we taxed or increased our military at 2.5%. Just draw your attention here to 1%, which is where our scenario start, to 227 to obviously to zero. Any questions on those more analytic statistics slides at all before we start to give the actual zero? Okay, good. Okay. Some of our potential budget uncertainties. The red right here, these we take it off this slide based upon some of the decisions we make at the end of the presentation. Uncertainties, obviously enrollment. We have a huge spike in enrollment in August, but specifically in the elementary center, we could have some uncertainties there as if we need to add an LTS. So we have much bigger decisions to make as far as classroom space. Special education costs. One or two placements that we didn't expect to come in would drive this budget in a different direction. Charter cyber school, same thing. If we have students leave, their cyber charter draws that drives that cost up higher than we budgeted. We're looking at using our contingency for that. Healthcare increase. This could be a positive. If we get lower than 5.5%, it's going to be a bigger win for us. And that's where it's capped at. Innovation wing. Decisions we're going to make upon that, where we're going to go, what direction to issue some debt service to pay for some of those things as far as the beyond improvements, or if we're going to use capital reserve and talk about that at a later moment. That's a decision that we're going to have to make too. The technology upgrades at Hills, as you saw there at 68,000. Yeah. Revenue uncertainties. If the budget changes. Now, I just told you that I feel comfortable at 100% of our EEF and SEF projections. But as you read in the paper yesterday, it was in the news, is that the state's having problems closing the number of tax revenue that they were expected to receive that is not meeting their benchmarks. So that could change the state budget for 17-18, which would change our budget. Property tax reform. I don't need to say anything more. Transportation subsidy decrease. The state or the governor is proposing a $50 million decrease in the state transportation subsidy decrease. When I spoke to Representative Gillian, he assured me that this should not affect our district. So I'm staying holding steady, flatlined with where our transportation subsidy is right now. That $50 million will come from other sources. Access funding. We spoke about that medical access funding. I'm drawing down on all those funds. Once again. And then any change in assessed value. This budget really doesn't take into consideration what we could know happened in 17-18. So we know that there's a potential for a Wawa coming. We don't know when that's going to occur. When the final bill is going to happen, it could happen in October, it could happen in December, it could happen in an interim period. My interims don't reflect that increase at all. But now Faber's building. We just spoke about that burden with the Yoakum Institute. Okay, those are all things that could come online this year. And with FIAC, that probably won't be until 18-19. So this budget doesn't take into consideration a big change in our assessed value for this year. Now next year's a different story because those things will be online. So current budget status. We're at $1.5 million deficit. That slide showed, the first slide that we talked about, it could come down to as low as $494,000. So we can reduce this significantly by making a few decisions. It could be lower than the percentage of taxes that we're looking at as far as this. Revenue assumptions. Global sources, 80% of our budget. Local sources, real estate tax, earned income tax, business privilege tax, that type of revenues in this area. So assessment based increase. Our assessed value did increase when we budgeted for 16-17 with 17-18 at 0.061%, which is about $733,000. not for statute, for anything. Does that include those things that we just spoke about? Real estate tax millage, right now, I have it at zero. Okay, so way below the 2.5 Act 1 index, millage rate would stay at 30.0665. State sources equals about 18.37%. Basic education, state education subsidy, I'm proposing 100% of what we're going to receive. We have new money. Retirement reimbursement will increase, obviously, because the rate increases because our wages increase. The transportation subsidy reflects flatline revenue, doesn't take into consideration what the governor's proposing is at $15 million. Federal sources. This would increase a little bit percentage-wise because I have zero access money for my budget. So we put that $200,000 in, it would go up to about 1%. So Title I and Title II are based on our allocations for 17. We had a small increase in Title I. We had a small, very small decrease in Title II. It was positive for us because our increase in Title I was greater than our decrease in Title II. Medical assistance access money. We'll get that decision later. Revenue history. This is our actual, it's blue. Excuse me, our actual spray, our budget is blue. As you can see, we, except for 1 year right here, we trend. Our actual is higher than our budget in the past 4 years, especially for all years except for 12. So we bring in more revenue than we budget. And that's mostly due to things like transfer taxes, like with hotels sold. We didn't expect that we had budget for that. And that was a huge injection of revenue. For the 1,000 was sold and they paid the back taxes. We didn't expect to receive those back taxes in that year. We didn't budget for that. So that was a huge injection of revenue. Things like that bring that delta. We go. That's like items like that are what caused that delta. So we hit what we budgeted. It's just that we didn't expect certain things to come in. A huge assessed value change that we didn't expect. Changes this right here. Any questions on revenue at all? Expenditure assumptions. Right now, all the salaries are in accordance with existing wage agreements. So right now, we have an agreement with ASPE, we have an agreement with WAEA, the Act 93 agreements there. All the wages are due to what those documents have for 478. Medical insurance, right now, maximum is 5.5% increase, which is really good. It's a really good rate. Employment retirement is obviously going to increase because of the 2.4% increase that we had with these restored. Okay, personnel changes. So, right now, we're proposing to add a math teacher, a science teacher, and additional 0.4 time on today's teacher for high school. We already added the nurse float, which was an increase in the budget. The OA is already starting, which is great. The autistic support we're getting right to interview with, so we're already moved down to do. But that's where we come in with that decrease. Instead of decreasers, because we had that, able to essentially one for one the position, which was great. That was a huge impact to this budget. We had retirement of an elementary kindergarten teacher, a first grade teacher. They were at the high end or the top end of the matrix. We brought that down as far as what we're budgeting. Still very fair of what we budgeted, so we have some room there too. And we had three replacements of some key individuals, a chemistry teacher, a French teacher, and another autistic support teacher. So now we're just hiring two autistic support teachers. So, both those teachers, they had a number of years, so replacement ends up a decrease with the 17. Yeah.
You're assuming it's a decrease, correct?
Right. This is an assumption, but the assumption, you have enough built into that assumption. So we're basically at, just for instance, someone's at a master's. We're up to a master's four. So we have three columns and some steps to work on. Okay, so there is some room to go based upon some experience in a different district. However, the hierarchy seems fit, we have some room to respond. Okay, yep, you're welcome, good question. All right, expenditures. Where's our events going? So, a lot of it's going to instruction, okay? $20 million to spend on instruction. Instruction. So where are we at? What's instruction? Instruction is regular ed special education. Majority of this is, oh, I'm sorry. The instruction there is based on wages, benefits, supplies. Anything that deals with what we consider in the accounting of the functions of 1,000 and 1,200s are here. This is where it's at. So a large portion of our dollars go to instruction. Support services, we have $10 million. Under support services are all of our plant operations, so all of our maintenance, staffing, all the dollars we need for maintenance contracts and supplies, it's all underneath there. Student transportation falls under student services at $928,000. The business office lies underneath there, administration, wages, and then functionality lies underneath there. Right here, other financing or other expenses and financing. This is our current debt services and our lease payments that we're making. So the lease payments for the technology that we have out there, and all of our debt service lies right there. And then the operation, the smallest part of our expenditures, is operation of non-instructional services, and that's student activities and community service. Any questions on this one? Expenditure history. As you can see, once again, blue is budget, gray is actual. 1450 was a small anomaly. That was when we had reissued some debt service for refinancing. So when we accounted for that expense, that our just the total reissuance was put in there, it drove our expenditures, our actual expenditures higher, but so was the revenue was higher. Equalize what the expenditures were, which are created on wash. So it looks like we overspent, but we actually didn't put in the revenue coming in. It's more of an accounting transaction than anything. But every other prior year, except for 12-13, we're spot on as far as our actual budget. But every other year we budgeted, we spent less. This graph here shows our revenue to expenditure. So 16-17 is our budget. We budgeted a deficit of $467,000. 17-18, right now we're at a $1.5 million deficit. But other years, you can see as we trend, every year we had revenues exceeding expenditures. Well, the next two slides are basically just breakdowns of where our expenditures are. We already reviewed this. We're at 56% instruction. There's no real change here, very small drop off, but it just got shifted with the pie. If you go to this slide here, this is a little bit different take. This shows the actual expenditures by object. So you can see that 43% salaries, now this does not include that 2.4 positions that we're adding, so this number would jump up. The reason why this number fell slightly is because our benefits increased on the pacers and health. So everything else relatively remains the same as far as percentage-wise. Not too much shifting of expenditures. Just to know that our largest part of our pie goes to salaries and benefits. This graph right here shows the PESER's contribution rate. So right now we're at 30.03. Next year we'll be at 32.57. We keep talking about when we reach the plateau, when this is going to finally level off. It keeps getting pushed. And I expect it to be continually be pushed and only get higher and higher. So these are the most recent projections as far as when we're going to level off. I mean, the finish line is getting closer, or it just keeps getting moved back further and further. I just want to direct you to the bottom right hand corner here. This is the chart as far as where our fund balance is for PESERS. I'm projecting to use that $507,000. So that would leave us with a fund balance of $3.6 billion. projecting that if this would be the only use of fund balance we have, we'd run out of the fund balance in 21-22. The deficit in 21-22. The trends this way. Any questions on expenditures at all? Okay. This here is, we got introduced to this last month. It's our forecast. It's the starting model. It's something that was in our elite goals. We're still kind of refining some of this right now. I want to direct you right here to some of the assumptions we used. Right now, we're using 0% increase in the village. But the assessed value did grow at that 0.061%, and the millage rate stays the same. On the out years, I bumped up this millage growth a little bit. It might be a little higher based upon what we know compared to the district. I used the index that we have now as far as the millage growth, 2.5%. So you can see what the tax rate would be if we improved the millage rate by 2.5%. Once again, this is just the forecast, no need to simplify it. So if we go to the bottom line here, ending fund balance, I am projecting that we would be running out of fund balance in 2021. We'd be at a negative fund balance of 723,000. One of the main reasons why I wanted to show you this slide was one, because that's promising. So I'm sort of forecasting for a while. The second was because of what we do here. So this here kind of essentially carries through forever. We do a zero here, this number doesn't change at all. Okay? It's not exponentially higher here only because we had a higher approach here in the compound, essentially. So I just wanted to point it out. That's why one of the reasons why we've done this slide. Second, this is a new slide that we added. It should be added here anyways. This is where our capital projects forecast was. We saw this a couple months ago, just as a refresh. Essentially, this is when we kind of loosely planned historic renovation. That can be altered. All this is able to be changed. Flattery Field, what we do with the track, and that is right around here. So I just wanted to show you this and say, look, we have some projects coming up. If we did have surpluses, such as what I'm projecting this year, and potentially next year, we could put that towards some of these projects that are maybe a huge amount of money that we're potentially going to expand. I mean, spend might not be $10 million, it might be higher than $10 million. But how we kind of position ourselves going forward is kind of key to what we do in those out years coming up. So we do know that we will have some sort of project here as well. Don't know what that cost is, but if we're trying to just forecast something and put it in placeholders, this is probably a pretty good number. So what we do and how we position ourselves for our fund balance going forward is kind of key to how much debt service we're going to be doing those outcomes. Who knows where the interest rates are going to be going forward. Okay. So this slide here, the red numbers all need to be adjusted because it's based upon what we make as far as our decision. So those numbers will change as well. And that would end our presentation for Monday night. So I go back to this slide. Where do we want to go? So this is where we have to kind of start making some decisions. We can start with the top one, number one. Or if we want to start bottom up, okay. It doesn't matter to me.
So if you look at these numbers, we have to use 464 unassigned fund balance to make things work with zero projection.
Correct.
But we have nearly $400,000 surplus this year that we applied to that theoretically to make that number closer to 60,000. So therefore, what we're really using is about 507 plus 6570 fund balance. But looking at historically what has happened with regard to revenues and expenditures, budget and actual, you know, it's theoretically possible that that may be utilized. You know, if we have a similar number as this one, we'd only end up using about 170 of that total if we had a $400,000 budget surplus next year, 17, 18. Is that correct?
Yes.
Because usually their budget for 16-17, they budget that tax increase in. That was included in the budget number. That wasn't anything additional. That wasn't great. It was just we got more revenues in than we projected, and prices put less money out than we thought.
Right now, yes. And mostly that was due to, yes, higher revenues coming in. We also had expenditures in as far as basic wages for subs and that was a real driver there. So it was separate charter school that our numbers were lower than what we budgeted. We always had our budget a buffer in there anyways, very small buffer. Those numbers came in under, which drove that. So we did have some expenditures that we did spend. It was about $11,000 on the check. The biggest driver was paying more revenue. So, yes. Theoretically, yes.
If things follow as they have been historically, because typically you don't spend all your wages. It's the nature of the game.
Yes, we budget for 100% and usually it doesn't take a good deal. And we've already had alternatives to that now because we need some support information and some quarter to maybe half a year. So we already helps this plan.
All right.
So apparently we just built in some savings. Right. And we can't count on that because if everyone was here 100% of the time, we would be expecting. Or if there's any changes, probably big changes that can occur essentially at any time. So this probably gets their credits to come in and their column. Now granted that's a $4,000 or $5,000 swing at the maximum. But it still is an expense that we did nursing because we budget for where we are going to this budget. We don't try to project too much as far as what this has to happen. But it is, it's one of those it's a moving target, right? It's, let's say it's constantly moving. We're just trying to throw the dart at the best possible. So right now this is where we are.
So what we in essence we will be using for the most part will be our people's reserve, which we have not used any of that money for to this point. $4.2 million.
Okay.
$4.2 million. I personally have no issue using some of that money at this point. And that's what it's there for. And I think that's what it's there for to utilize. And I almost see that's almost all we're utilizing based upon the service we have for this year that will apply next year when we roll over, which will really almost plus these using out of our assigned fund balance, which that's actually 1%.
Right. But we do use them. We are assigning and using the fund balance versus. So we are using some of those assignments. It's just not sitting there for one moment. So consciously we take the effort to say, okay, we assign this money, this is not going to sit in the offers and wait. We are using it for emergency needs. We're not going to get into a situation in other districts in the Commonwealth and say, okay, well, we're going to go for the exceptions, tax up the exceptions. And then bring in a huge surplus because and did not spend the money. Yeah, the fund balance is there for reasons for one time purchases with instruments. So one time purchase in many years. We put them from a long time, that's a 10-year purchase. So
is there any sentiment to do anything other than zero? People think that we should impose a tax increase. Try to get a layup for a fix.
My concern about not doing it in a minimal amount is look, there was an article last week about the school that did not impose any tax on this last year. This year now, I'm proposing to do that 2.5 and regret that they did not take the opportunity when they had it to get additional income. So that would be my only concern. Of course, so many unknowns, if you miss an opportunity to literally increase, I would hate the next year then to have to go to the 2.5. However, historically speaking, you're right, we have in the last couple of years come up with surpluses. So, you know,
I really had a hard time saying what the intention was. My feeling. that still leaning toward. I mean,
we continually get surpluses. I just always have a hard time saying. I mean, yes, a penny saved is a penny earned, but we're continually saving money.
We got increased positions. We just spent $500,000 on new tennis courts. We're looking at a brand new track at the high school. We're looking at a high school renovation. And this is all stuff coming in the pipeline in the next 5 or 10 years. You know, and we're not setting ourselves up if we're not saving.
I think you're sort of both sides as well.
And I hear what you're saying, right? If a surplus is reduced, that can be your link to your footprint or project.
Correct, because before you make the conscious effort, there is a surplus this year or next year, to put it right to capital reserve. So you can take it, you want to put it into your fund balance, you can put it right into capital reserve to help pay for some of these projects.
So is our decision point between 0.5 and 0, or is that more or less where we're sitting at?
What's the 0.5? 0.5 and the other 13,000. And then the 1 and the other 13,000.
Yeah. So,
just up to
who's for,
I used to calculate it.
Who's for 0? Who's for 0? You have 1 for 0. I'm still.
I'm half up.
What do you think, George?
You know, I agree with everything you're saying, unfortunately, which makes this a tough decision because we have to keep having a surplus, but at the same time, I don't want to make a decision for the person who won't know. Just to talk about finance, you know, what's happening, what's sitting there. So I kind of look at it as with all these projects coming. I'm definitely against the 1% share for that. But I do believe in making decisions now for today, but probably 5 years from now, whether that's one of the responsibilities. With being conscious to,
going
gangbuster, and we have all this money. It's a tough call. Taxpayer as well.
You don't know what who's going to bring. You may have that, so we have that conversation next year, but again, I don't.
I would hate to look at some of the guys Ryan said and said, we're going to have to go to 2.2, or some of those galactic numbers we saw, like 6%, 5%, 9%. That was just absurd times. I don't know what that was, but that wasn't here, so it doesn't matter. Well, it doesn't matter. But, I just feel that we should be planting seeds for the future and staying ahead of the game. Not too far ahead, but just.
I agree. I mean, I think 0.5 is palpable enough that it's.
As a taxpayer, I don't want to. So I'm just trying to. I can't sit here and say I don't want to raise taxes because that's the responsible thing. I don't know what's around the corner. I want to prepare for the corner.
But to your point, it does seem like there's a lot of positives coming. From my world of things, when Wawa says they want something, they usually get it. I mean, it may fall apart, but there's not too many times those sorts of deals.
I'll tell you, Wawa just fell out of the roof on the free across from us next to the Volkswagen. And it's going across the street, which we got from Tom Baldwin, Jesus. But they're a good that guy.
Well, we looked at that one across
the
street.
And
they
backed
so
out. Things do happen. With phase one environmentals, phase two environmentals, you don't know what's being right in front of you. So that's the scope of what we do now.
Okay. So the Open Institute is the type of the central property right now. This would become the one. This is all brand new. Assess value to us. It's tax. Okay. We're not getting anything right. But it's residential property. It is. But still, the improvements are going to be in there, plus just the assessed value. Even if they get improvements on there, it's going to be online as well. That's going to assess where it works. No question. VF in a year, they all bring to the package, just not the assessed value. It's the earning of the employees that are going to be there. It's a business privilege tax that they're going to start paying. It's all of those components that they bring to the game. That's going to happen. The open institute is going to happen. And now our fabric building, at some point, which already started to improve a little bit, it is going to happen. Now that's going to be graduated in part, and part is going to be instantaneous. So,
and more in reality, the only thing I would say to everyone here, who's going to be here but not, is I don't think $113,000, if Armageddon happens, you put up there for a 5-year forecast, $113,000 is not going to change that. That is a significant step. I mean, it just isn't.
No, it would make prolong it a little bit.
If you have numbers like we're $2 million in the hole in 5 years, if that comes to pass, $113,000 this year is not going to
compounding it. It's going to have a good interest rate.
Let's say it's $150,000, that's going to be then. So instead of 2.2 in the hole, we're going to be, 2.1 in the hole. You know, it's like, so. I think to some extent, the 0% is more or less the best the community saying, we hear you, we care, we can do it, we're doing it, we're not promising next year, but it's more or less symbolic. That's just my mind. But as I said, this is going to be a decision of the board. I don't want to press this because, again, you guys got to make decisions next year. I won't be. So I don't want to. But, I'm just trying to get a sense for a lay of the word.
Well, I think I'm
going
to
do 100%
of the starting to see the slide of future projections.
Okay.
So that's where.
Now we have to tax you this larger amount. So what's the better deal? Because either way,
that's how it's going to turn out.
No, I mean, I hear what you're saying. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have an odd number, which is good. So we're good. I mean, do we want to say, raise your hand if you want 0, and raise your hand 1.5, and whatever width becomes a recommendation.
Can you answer that question? What's better to the community? Small increments? I'd like to discuss that.
I think it depends on who you talk to.
Exactly.
I think it depends on who you talk to. Some people would say, looking at what we have, knowing what we know, they'd say, well, you know, we just don't believe you need this because historically, if you look at the fact that we have surpluses every year, some years significant, you know, that people may not have confidence in the budgeting process, knowing what we know. And what they may say is, yeah, I hear what you're saying. If your budgeting process is 100% accurate, it's not, and it tends to be inaccurate in a way that's not favorable to the taxpayer. So somebody looking at it from that perspective is going to say, I hear what you're saying. Budget numbers are 100% accurate. You know, yeah, we agree, but they're not. We don't think they are. And they tend to be, the tendency always when we do school district financing is that you can't have it flipped the other way. Like, it's Armageddon for someone like you. If you say this, and instead of being a surplus, it flips to a deficit. And that's like a bad thing. And I think this is not a knock on you. You know, I had the same conversation with John Green at BCTC. You know, it's they tend to make sure that that doesn't flip that way. They make sure if it flips anywhere, it flips this way. You know, so I think it depends on what somebody would know and what the person is. How is there any answer to that? You can bring 20 people in here and ask the question and get 10 say yes and 10 say no.
Those increases could be clearly higher than $130,000.